your senses. What can you do in there? The thought of you condemning you to your suffering. Is that what you really want? Prison inside a prison, marking your time on.
And here we are, Tampa, Florida, and what was the start of a very emotional trip. Hey everybody, Mr. Bucketlist is on break right now, so this is actually me, Justin, checking in. It's good to see you. Now just to give you all a little bit of a background on this trip and this video in general, I am not a political person, this isn't a political channel, and this is not a political video, so I was a little bit worried about if I uploaded this, I mean, what's going to be said, what's going to happen, things like that. But I thought about it, I said, hey, this is my channel, I can easily block people, I can take comments away. This is more about history. This trip was to educate myself and myself only, and I'm just sharing you all that experience with me. So that's pretty much how things worked. Now, being that this trip was more about self-education more than anything, I didn't have my usual parameters that I have when I go on vacations, so it wasn't about the luxury hotel, luxury food, it wasn't about the cool vehicle, the cool destination, it was literally just about learning. So for example, when I got my rental car, I told the guy, I said, hey, give me the cheapest, most friendly, family-friendly looking vehicle out there, and this is what I got. Now, I'm not one to complain, but this vehicle's gas tank was literally about either 8 or 9 gallons, and it felt like I was filling up every couple of hours. It was so ridiculous, but it got the job done. And finally, I was on my way. Now, actually on my way to this city that was right outside of Montgomery, Alabama. I will be honest, I was both nervous and anxious. I mean, going here, making a trip like this, not really knowing how the people are going to be there. I mean, I had literally about close to 10 hours of driving just to think about what I was getting myself into. So many emotions came through my head, but it was all about the experience. Like, I really wanted to understand and learn this for myself, exactly what went down in these places. And not only that, but how are these places now versus how they were in the 60s, the 70s, the 50s. I just wanted to see the difference, and so I had so much emotion built up into me already. And I'll be honest with you all, this was the most positive part of this trip, going there, because everything else from day two going forward, it really hurt me, to say the least. And then one last positive thing before I get into the seriousness of this trip itself. So living in Florida, we don't have any cookouts, and cookouts is something I love back at home in North Carolina. So just seeing a cookout literally right across the street from my hotel was amazing. I was so happy, but this is almost like the last part of joy of this trip. And then speaking of the hotel, so it was actually really strange. This is what kind of set the mood for this entire trip. When I got there, the guy didn't say, hey, welcome, how you doing? He just, first thing he said was ID, credit card. And that was literally the extent of our conversation. Didn't tell me about the Wi-Fi password, if they had one. Didn't tell me about breakfast. Didn't tell me anything. And I was just like, oh, goodness, here we go. So just letting you all know, this was almost where my joy ended for this trip. But I still wanted to go forward because this is for me. And thankfully, the hotel room itself wasn't bad at all. So it was finally time to head to my first destination of this civil rights trip, and it was actually Selma, Alabama. Now, in all honesty, again, this is the reason why this trip was such an educational trip for me, because I had no idea of the importance of the city of Selma and the bridge until the movie Selma. I watched the movie and really enjoyed it. I was like, wow, why did I not know all this? And so that was one reason why I wanted to make this trip. Again, I just really wanted to educate myself, and wow. Baby, you understand me now. Now, outside of the way the actual city looks, at least the neighborhood that I went through, just the actual weather, the atmosphere, I mean, it was just a gloomy, just depressing vibe the entire trip. And then, I mean, just you all saw what I came from in Tampa versus what I went to in Alabama and eventually Mississippi and Tennessee. It was just, oh man, it was just extremely upsetting. Just everything in disrepair. It was just shocking, to say the least. Now, of course, just driving over the bridge itself wasn't enough. I actually wanted to get out and step and just walk in the same footsteps as all those people that had that movement. And this, it hit me. I mean, you've seen the Alabama River, being on that bridge. Oh, man, it really did something to me, you all. You have no idea. It was hard.
For that violence to take place on that Sunday in Selma.
And what also hit me pretty hard was just being able to pull out my drone and getting an eagle eye view of the city itself. I mean, it was rough. It was really rough. I'm like, I felt bad for the people that's living there, because it just, I don't know. It just, the whole vibe of that city just really felt off to me. I just did not enjoy it. Another thing that caught my eye when I did some research on visiting this bridge was the Civil Rights Memorial Park. And what it basically is it is a physical park, but it also has different memorials of different leaders and just people in general that were important to both history and the area itself. And so again, just walking through it, just reading their biographies and things like that, it was just hard. It's just hard to see basically what took place before I was alive during my parents' age. It was just really tough. And then one thing I noticed, I mean, of course it's a memorial park, so it's not going to be the most joyous place to be. But just seeing how, again, that felt just so just in disrepair and abandoned. It's just like, man, you got these people being memorialized, but then where they're at is falling apart as well. It's really unfortunate. Now, when I was walking back to my car, it just really hit me. I'm like, man, I can't believe I'm actually doing this. Like, I was literally almost ready to go after just leaving that memorial. Like, I was like, okay, you know what? I've seen enough. It's time to head back to Florida. But I wanted to complete this trip for me. Like I said, this is about my education. I just really wanted to learn what happened. I mean, you can only get but so much from watching videos like this one, for example. But being there, it's just it's a completely different feeling. You get to understand the vibe, what those people actually went through. And that was my goal. I just really wanted to understand what happened and how it is right now. So after leaving Selma and just going through all those emotions, my next place I wanted to head to was going to be Montgomery, Alabama. Now in Montgomery, Alabama, there was actually a couple of places I wanted to stop. The main place I wanted to go to was a place called the Legacy Museum, which also included the National Memorial for Peace and Justice. At least from my research, what this basically was just the legacy of, I guess, just slavery and black people, things like that. And just civil rights and other things. And so I didn't really know much about it because, you're not allowed to record in there. And not only that, but I just didn't want to ruin it for myself. I said, hey, this is a new museum. I want to save the experience for myself, like firsthand, get those raw emotions, just see how it goes. And even with that positive outlook, I just was not prepared for what was coming. So on the positive side of this experience, what I can say is this is the most well done, put together, emotional, moving museum I have ever been to. Not to mention it was extremely cheap. I mean, the museum itself was a $5 donation to get in there, and it's made of a warehouse. Not only is it made of a warehouse, but it has two different sections that's literally across town. It was beautiful. It was extremely sad, powerful, moving. And I understand why they don't want people to actually record while you're in there, because I don't want to spoil it for you all, but it literally moved me. And it's not one of those type of museums where it's trying to set an agenda or has this message or nothing like that. It's just telling you facts. It goes from A to B to Z. It just goes down the letters. Like, it's just, I'm sorry. It has me wrapped up talking about it right now, but it really got me. If I had the time, I would have spent all day there, but I had a lot to do, and this is a very short trip. But it was powerful. It was extremely powerful. If there was one museum I could recommend in the world for you all to go to, this would be it. Do not miss it. With that said, after I got out the museum, I just sat down and I just had to breathe. My heart started racing. And I started getting really just upset and just, man, I just wasn't feeling the way like I usually do. Like, usually I'm pretty chill about almost everything, but I went through some things, and that was just the first part. When I went to the second part, the part you actually can record in, I'll go ahead and throw it up right now, but that just made things just 10 times worse, because this is more about just people and what they died for. It was basically just a huge memorial, and like it's called, the Memorial for Peace and Justice. So going there, like I said, just seeing all those names and people getting lynched for being drunk, or getting lynched for being short on change, or getting lynched for walking on the wrong side of the street. It was just the silliest things that people were getting killed for. And it's so much more that's probably not included in this museum. It hurt me. I'm like, man, this is just nuts. I can't believe this. And again, this is why I took that trip, because I really wanted to educate myself as far as what happened. You can talk to four or five different people and ask them what happened on this time. Everyone's going to have their own difference of opinion, so I want to learn this for myself, what truly was going on, and this was, at least for me, the best way to do it. And then just kind of going back to the museum itself, so the setup is you can go to either one first. You can go to the memorial one first, which is just, like I said, just a huge memorial, or you can go to the actual museum first. It's up to you, but the ticket includes both. It's $5, it's cheap. It has a shuttle that takes you back and forth. And then not only that, but they actually had this little restaurant that's right beside it, beside the gift shop. And at first I didn't want to go, but then I said, you know what, I'm hungry. I want to support this place the best way I can, so I went and got some food. The food was really good as well. The experience itself, it just put me in a place I've never been. It literally had me lost for words, and that really doesn't happen to me much. I mean, you all know I travel and do stuff all the time where it's hard for me to get surprised or excited about anything anymore, unfortunately, but this did it. So after that moving experience, I just had to take a walk. And I said, you know what? I'm in the city of Montgomery. It's a very well-known city. let me just walk and see what it has. And so on the shuttle ride from the actual museum, I kept seeing this little, like, it looks like a Riverwalk type thing, and it reminded me of something in Tampa. So I went to go check it out, but again, the vibe itself was just so gray and so down. I was just like, I don't really feel like doing this. And so, I mean, I walked around for a little bit, and then I was ready to go on to my next destination, which was actually pretty cool because it was one of the homes that Dr. Martin Luther King used to live at. So making it to this home of Dr. Martin Luther King Jr.'s was just really, like the rest of the trip, just really moving. I'm familiar that he has many homes across the country that he resided in, but just finally being to my first one was just really, moving. Now, the unfortunate thing was because of COVID and, of course, budget cuts and all this other stuff, it wasn't open, so I wasn't able to go inside, but just being to sit on the swing that he's probably sitting and sitting on the steps, it was just really cool. It really felt cool to be there. It felt like an accomplishment that I actually am proud of to do.
Who are they to judge us?
Mother,
mother,
simply call us we where our hair long.
Mother, mother,
So after that, just up and down as far as my experiences in both Selma and Montgomery, Alabama, it was finally time to head to Jackson, Mississippi, because my next stop was going to be Megan Everett's home. I was a little bit concerned, so I actually had used Hotwire to get almost just one of the cheapest hotels I can find in an area right outside of Jackson, Mississippi. It was 3 stars, so I said, you know what, if it's 3 stars, I'll take it. It shouldn't be that bad. And to my delight and surprise, this hotel had just opened up. The young lady behind the counter was so bubbly and so nice. I was like, you gotta be kidding me. Like, I was just literally shocked. Like, when I walked in the hotel and I even, when I got to the parking lot, I was like, man, this place is nice. When I walked inside, I talked to her. She was nice and cool. When I walked to my room, I saw how nice it was. It had my name on the TV. I was like, you gotta be kidding me. Like, this is like something I would literally find when I'm on vacation and I'm trying to spend good money on a hotel. This is a place I would choose, like, and probably spend a lot more money than what I actually did spend. And it was just, this is what I needed to keep the journey going, because I was literally so done after seeing Selma and going to that museum and then seeing Dr. Martin Luther King's. I was just so done, you all. And then it just raised my spirit so much. Like, I am so happy that this is the way the night ended, because this is exactly what I needed.
In 1963, Medgar Evers, the NAACP secretary for Jackson, Mississippi.
I'm gonna be straight up with you. This one day right here changed my entire outlook on life, period. And probably after you all watch this video, you'll see where I'm coming from. I just was not having it. But before I get into that, let's always start with the positives. The breakfast itself at this really good hotel was on point. Even though I will say there was this lady that was following me around. She was one of the employees. I guess she thought I was off the street, and I literally had to lay my cart on my table I was eating to let her know back up. But other than that, the food was good. So even though I had a really good breakfast, I had to keep myself grounded in reality, because I was actually heading to a very important place, and this place was the home of Megar Evers. Now the reason why this means so much to me, not only because of course it's Megar Evers, but one of my professors, and this is my favorite professor of all time, his name was Lee Merrill. When we first met him, he told us about how he was involved in the Megar Evers trial. He was on the prosecution team. And this is an older white man. He was really serious. And it's weird because at first he really creeped me out. I was scared of the man. He seemed so intimidating. But he actually became one of my best friends. And he's one of the best professors I ever had. Me and him would talk for hours after class just about just life in general. He taught me so much, and I really hope this video comes across to his attention some way, somehow. If it doesn't, whatever. But I did this for him because for people that don't know, this man, he killed Megar Evers in his driveway and then ran around bragging about it, because basically he was white. It was around the time period where white men weren't getting arrested for things like that. He thought he was untouchable. So the prosecution team, including Dr. Lee Merrill, my professor, like I said, put that man away, and it was unheard of for the time being. They just, seeing a white man going to jail for shooting a black man was just, especially in a place like Mississippi, it just, you just would never think it would happen. And I mean, honestly, it's very similar to what almost happens today. And that's why this trip, even though it was completely out the way for me, I had to make this trip. This is just something I had to do.
Frustration and discord are burning in every city, north and south. A great change is at hand. And our task, our obligation.
Medgar Evers had been shot in the back by a single round from a high-powered rifle. The one fingerprint found on the weapon belonged to Byron De La Beckwith, a member of the Citizens Council in Greenwood, Mississippi.
And then just like going to that bridge, it was just so surreal to be at this man's house in this neighborhood, being out there. I just, again, I was lost for words. And he ended up being the first white man to be convicted of killing a black person in the state of Mississippi. So that just kind of started everything. And as you can see, the sign right here says the site of the tragedy. So it shows everything. And then also, just like Dr. King's house and almost all these other places I visited, these are literally in the middle of neighborhoods. So while I was looking like a tourist, just going around, getting emotional, taking pictures, some girl was walking to the bus stop and said, "Hey, good morning, how you doing?" And it kind of blew me away. I'm like, man, this is like in somebody's neighborhood. Like, this is where people live. And I try to stay grounded in reality, but it was just hard to do so because it's unthinkable that people actually live in these areas where these atrocities took place. It's just hard to put into words.
Medgar Evers, 37 years old, died 1 hour later.
The brutal murder of Medgar Evers came as shocking and tragic news to all.
Former U.S. Marine and white supremacist Byron De La Beckwith is arrested just days after Evers' funeral, smiling for the camera.
So before I leave this place, please, you all, everything I've talked about in this video, I'll try my hardest to leave some links or something. Like I did, educate yourself, because like I said, my professor, I mean, I had him for a class called Social Methods. It was actually a graduate level class that somehow I was able to get into. But he taught me so much. Like I said, this is an older white man that taught me so much. And he changed the world. His team changed the world. These little incidences and these situations that I went to have changed the world. So, I mean, I just implore you to just learn about what truly happened. If it was before your time or even during your time, learn about what truly happened. It's only going to benefit you. And if you are watching this video, Dr. Merrill, I just want to say thank you. I wish we have kept in contact. It's been years since we talked, but your experience at East Carolina University literally changed my just way of thinking. Thank you. Now, my next place that I wanted to go to, I was just extremely nervous and just anxious and just scared, honestly, because I know the history of this place. I know what happened. And this is the one incident that really just got to me. I mean, all these incidents just got to me, but this one right here, it just, when I first learned about it and I first saw the pictures and things like that, it really just hit me hard. And so going to this place, I had a lot on my mind going there, and I'll tell you all right now, when I was literally driving there, I started singing. I'm not somebody that sings. It is what it is, but I had this song on repeat for the entire 3-hour drive to get there, over and over again, and I'm not going to say what song it was, because it's not like an emotional song, but I was singing, and I was just hitting notes I've never hit before, but I was just changed, man. That's just the best way to put it. Now that we're in Sumner, Mississippi, you all probably have, if you made it to this far in this video, you know that I'm not glorifying the death of anybody. I'm not talking about what happened. I'm just telling you all how I felt, because I mean, the facts of whatever happened, I can go to so many different news sources and they're all going to say something different. So I just rather not speak about that and just tell you all about my experience. But this one I do want to talk about, because this is a child that was involved. And I mean, the pictures are there. I mean, it's just that simple. He was tortured, he was killed. His mother left an open casket because she wanted everybody to see exactly what happened to her son. And it was sickening. I mean, I don't have any kids, and this is one of the reasons why, because I told myself I don't want to raise a child in a society that I may end up having them lost or having to go through something like this. It's just, it's so many reasons why I don't want to have children, at least for right now. And this is one of the reasons why I just...
that have come out here to see what we're talking about and see what we're doing and what we're trying to do.
And going here, I just felt that vibe, that same vibe I felt in Selma, that same vibe I felt in Montgomery. The vibe here was like 10 times worse because it really felt like nothing has changed. And it just, man, it was sickening. So with my time in Sumner, there are no positive portions about this, even the little tour I set up. So I wanted to do a tour of the Emmett Till Interpretive Center. And basically when I got there, it was some guy and he was just pretty much just like, well, since you're not a big group, I really can't give you a tour. We only say those for big groups. And so he basically was like, just walk around. There was nothing there. I was extremely upset. This is what happens to solo travelers. And he probably had no idea of my capabilities as far as what I can do with my work. But it is what it is. That really just kind of set me off. And I hadn't even gotten to the part that I knew it was going to upset me. And so just giving you all a heads up, I was already mad. And then when I walked to the courthouse, it really just, bang, it hit me. So they intentionally kept the courthouse to look the same exact way it looked during the trial of Emmett Till. And I have mixed feelings about it because yes, it was, for me to see, it was very educational, but at the same time, it's like, man, like, why did this even happen in the first place? It's so many emotions came over me and I was upset. I mean, I'm getting upset now just thinking about it. But again, I was lost for words when I was there. I was sick to my stomach. I could not wait to leave. I spent more time getting there than I did actually exploring the place because I just did not like what I was feeling whatsoever. All right, so I'm leaving. I've had enough. It is time to head to Tennessee. Now, other YouTubers that have done these type of videos, especially for this area, they like to go to like the river where they believe he was killed in the shed and things like that. Out of respect, I didn't do that. Plus, I just didn't feel comfortable. I didn't want to go out there and Clan Riley was out there and I'm getting killed. So I literally want to stay as, in these type of towns, I want to stay as visible as possible to the public in case something were to happen because I was truly scared out of my mind. And this is one place I could not wait to get out of. So to break up the seriousness, I will say this. I was so mad, but I was so hungry, and I did not trust the food in that city. I was like driving mad and just hungry. It was just a really bad combination, so thankfully I made it safe. But I did finally eat in Memphis, Tennessee. And since I was there, they had some Memphis Red Hot, some type of little chicken tenders you can get from KFC. I never had them before, so I tried them out, and they're actually really good. I was really surprised. But with that said, this was my final stop on the trip before I decided to go back home. And this was going to be the most emotional and depressing one. This is the death site of Martin Luther King Jr.
Eyewitnesses to the assassination say that Dr. King left his room 306 at the Lorraine Hotel just before...
Now, before I go into detail about this actual museum, the one thing I will mention is I actually did look this up on YouTube years ago because I didn't think I would make a trip like this. I was curious. And there was this lady that's known to boycott the place. She's there every single day and she boycotts it. And the reason why is she says that the city, the government, whoever is in charge of that building is making a profit off of his death. And so she says she doesn't agree with it, so she boycotts it. And in the past, I didn't really understand where she was coming from, but now it's just, it makes sense. And I mean, I'm not gonna say I 100% agree with her, but I understand why. Like, it's just, it is a spectacle. And what really kind of hammered it home for me was, when I got the car and I was going to the actual museum itself, there was this family, it was a white family, and there was these little kids and they were running around so excited, and the dad was like, come on, let's hurry up, let's get in line as soon as we can. And so they went running like they were running to like an amusement park ride. And I'm just like, what? It was so confusing. And it was literally right in front of that lady's little desk who boycotts the museum. So, I mean, that really upset me. I mean, this is not something to be excited to see. Like, this is just... I don't know how to put it, but I was not feeling when I saw that scenario, and everybody else there was pretty respectful, and I didn't like that.
We have information that King has been shot at the Lorraine.
So I get it. I get where that lady was coming from, and for me, going to this museum, this was like essential to wrap up my trip, because I had no idea when you go inside, it's not just about Martin Luther King and him getting killed at that motel. It was about civil rights in general. I mean, that's the whole name of it. It's the National Civil Rights Museum. And it just had things from Rosa Parks. It had things from Medgar Evers, from Emmett Till, from Bloody Sunday on the Selma Bridge. All these different things that I had learned about through this trip was all in this museum. And it ended with the death of Martin Luther King Jr. And so it was moving. It's giving me emotions right now. I don't know how to put it in words without offending people, but it really just made me feel like, man, like it felt like I've been lied to all my life, and it sucks. It really, really sucks. I mean, a lot of people like to pretend that these things are such a long time ago. To me personally, I don't think 30, 40, 50 years, even 60 years is a long time ago. When I think of a long time, I think about centuries. It wasn't that long ago, and throughout those other museums that I saw, the parallels are so similar today as they were back in the day. Not much has changed, and so that's what really got under my skin, because I'm like, man, these people are still, it's just still happening, is what I'm trying to say. And it sucked. It really, really sucked.
Some friends below, he leaned over and began to speak with them. Police say 205 feet away, in a window in a flophouse, the assassin waited.
And then, of course, to see that room that he last stayed in, of course, it was all blocked off, but you can see through it. Basically, had bulletproof glass, but everything was preserved. So the way the sheets were, the food that was in there, his materials, all that stuff was preserved to the way it was at the time of his death. So, I mean, it's just hard. It was just really hard to see, because that was that just pretty much changed the course of the country. And that was just a very emotional thing to be in front of. It just, again, I was lost for words when I was there. Not to mention, I had no idea, but the actual boarding house that the man shot him from, it was included with the museum. And I don't think you could charge for that one. You could just walk over there if you wanted to for free.
He waited, police believe, in a bathroom down the hall from the room he rented but 4 hours earlier. To get a clear...
All right, I apologize, I'm not talking too much. I'm just so out of it right now. But this is the bathroom, y'all. So that's the window, and then that's where he took the shot.
pretty scary.
But just going there as well, I mean, it's just like, man, like that man who went through all that just to shoot somebody and kill him and just, man, I mean, I understand it's a controversial as far as if the guy was working with the government or not. I'm not getting to that. Like I said, this video is more about my experience. I'm not going to try to add in those little things I have no idea about. But either way, it was just a really hard museum to go to and see. It was just a really hard place to be. Man, it sucked.
His target squarely, and then he ran. Out of the bathroom and along the decrepit hallway, turning, he raced down the rickety wood stairs and out.
So usually when I make these documentaries, I always try to leave on a positive note. And I just, I honestly can't do it for this video. It took me, if you all saw the Christmas trees and stuff like that in the background of some of my shots in these videos, I mean, this video was done, I think the same week during Christmas, right before Christmas. And so, I mean, it took me a while to get this video out because I was so upset right afterwards, where the tone and the direction of this video would have been completely different than what it came out to be as of today, because I have a clearer head now and all those emotions, for the most part, aren't really as prevalent as they were when I was first recording, to put it nicely. So, like I said, I don't have really any positive wrap-up. All I can say was this trip itself, it opened my eyes and it changed my direction as far as what I want to do. Everyone should have their own accomplishments and goals. Mine used to be, oh, I want to go and see the world and have fun and travel, do this and that, and maybe get married, maybe have kids and this and that. And now I just feel like, no, my goal in life now is to actually just educate myself, understand where I'm coming from, and just leave a lasting positive impact on the earth, whatever that may be. I want to be that person. It's not just about me anymore. So that's all I can say, but I hope you all enjoyed this video. Again, this is Justin, Mr. Bucklist. He's chilling, he sleeps somewhere. This is Justin right now, and it's good to meet you all, and I'll see you soon.